And thank you for introductions. And hello, everyone. My name is Jean Garash from UNDP. And I'm going to present the WebGIS which we are developing, which is called GeoHub. And I'm working as a full stack GIS developer in UNDP SDG integration team to develop this GeoHub. And firstly, what is UNDP? UNDP is one of UN agencies and which try to help countries to eliminate poverty and reduce inequalities and exclusions. And also UNDP plays a critical role in helping, supporting countries to achieve SDG goals. Also geospatial data is ubiquitous. But previously UNDP has little tradition to use GIS. We haven't actually effectively utilized geospatial data set in the organization. Geospatial can be used to enforce data-driven policy makings. For example, where do people live without access to electricity, or which area can be affected by floods like that. And then to support such policy makings, we are developing GeoHub, and GeoHub is a centralized ecosystem of geospatial services to support UNDP staff and development policy makers and the broader development communities in the context of SDGs. There is a QR code in the last of this slide of GeoHub. If you access to GeoHub, there is a landing page first, and GeoHub has mainly four functionality currently. First one is about data. And the second one is visualize and map. And the third one is about spatial analytics tool. We have developed several analytical tools for decision making. And the last one is a dashboard for some customized data set. So GeoHub is a first main purpose is a central, it's a centralized geospatial database. UNDP has a lot of country offices all over the world. We want to manage all the geospatial data set in one place from country offices and headquarters. And also manage some third-party data sets through Stack or any maybe OGC APIs in a one place. And we manage using Azure Blob Storage and PostGIS for those data sets. And for the database, we also provide the searching functionalities. So user can search from a data set page or a data tab in the map page to search a data set to add to a layer and to GeoHub map. And then there are multiple ways to visualize geospatial data set. User can switch easily between linear storage legend or classified legend. Or if it's a vector data, can label easily in intuitive UI, and also can filter data or transforming raster data set in user-friendly GUI. And after user visualizing, user can save a map and share with their colleagues. And when user can save a map, can select an access level. So user maybe first want to save a map completely privately for himself. Once ready, maybe he can change access level to within organizations, UNDP, Or maybe if UNICEF user log in to Johab, this organization level can be changed to UNICEF name. And also can make map completely public. Yeah. So unsigned in user can also see map if access level set to public. Yeah. And we also have some analytical tools developed. Currently we have four type of tools. Yeah, first one is a rapid change assessment tool. And the second one is a subnational human development index simulation tool. And the third one is subnational heat health index simulation tool. And then last one is terrain add-ons. A user can transform a raster digital elevation model data set to maybe hillshade layer or contours layers. Yeah, terrain RGB layers like that dynamically. Yeah. And this is one example of a use case of a rapid change assessment. So there was a flood on 11th of September 2023 in Libya, Derna. Yeah. You can see some picture for this flooding. So use the rapid change, our rapid change assessment tool. In the first picture, maybe this first picture is showing the changes between the before event and after event of nighttime light. Yeah. So if nighttime light changes become negative, it's showing red. Yeah. If nighttime light activity become positive, it's showing blue. And the second one is this overlay on Maxa Open Data Catalog. Yeah. And so these red part, actually we can see, yeah, this rapid change assessment tool works quite well, yeah, to affect the area. And the right side of the next picture, this is overlaying Microsoft. It's difficult to some pointing to, yeah, this one. It's overlaying on Microsoft Google Open Buildings. So you can see that there was some buildings here, but flood removed completely this area by comparing open building. And this left one is comparing with World Pop data. Yeah, it's this area has quite a lot of population in World Pop, yeah. And the high population area affected area. So maybe, yeah, so this kind of rapid change assessment tool is available for GeoHub for policy making. And last functionality is the dashboard for specific data set. Currently we have electricity dashboard to show some electricity access, yeah, in the African continent or and other areas. Yeah. But this is showing our proposed version 2 design. If you access the current GeoHub, it's showing a slightly different design. We are improving UI, but this version 2 design will be deployed soon. And from here, I'm going to talk about what technologies, open source software, you used in GeoHub. And this is the whole structure of GeoHub. You can see GeoHub is quite a complex system. Yeah. And in the front-end side, in the front-end side, we deployed Azure App Services. We are using Svelte and MapLibre to develop front-end website. And also some back-end endpoint, we are using SvelteKit. SvelteKit is a full-stack JavaScript framework. We can develop both front-end and back-end together. Yeah. And in the back-end, We are deploying everything in Kubernetes. And for the last, we are using Ttira to process last cog file from blob storage account or stack. Yeah. And let me show this one. Yeah. So for the last tile, we are using Ttira. And from stack, we have our own UNDP stack and the Microsoft Planetary Computers, Asset, Axe, Jackson, yeah, from stack API or stack catalog. Yeah. And some cog file, user uploaded file will be converted to cog file by our data pipeline. Yeah. And using Ttira to consume these cog file from stack or blob storage account to render last tile dynamically. Yeah. And also we can apply some customized algorithms through Ttira or maybe any expression to make a product from the last data set. Yeah. This Ttira is quite a powerful open source maintained by development sheets. Yeah. And go back to this one. Yeah. And here, we are also using pgtile sub, yeah, for the dynamic vector dataset. Yeah. Pgtile sub is a dynamic vector tile server directly serving vector tiles from PostGIS database. We deployed a Postgres function in the database, yeah, and the pgtile sub can distribute dynamic vector tiles, and we have GUI to allow users to dynamically change parameters. For example, this is a heat health index simulation tool, for example. User can change life expectancy, expected educations, dynamically change parameters to see how the heat health index will be changed if this index is improved. Yeah. And for the static vector, we are using PM tiles. So through our data pipeline, when user uploads the vector dataset like shapefile or geopackage, or most of geospatial data format we are supporting, and that data pipeline will convert to PM tiles. And we use Maplibre to consume these PM tiles to visualize them. Yeah. And for the rapid change assessment tool, we developed our own UNDP stack catalog to manage nighttime light data collection from School of Mines, Colorado. Yeah. So this is our GitHub repository for UNDP stack pipelines. This pipeline is deployed to Azure Kubernetes, and every day convert original cog file from School of Mine to cog file and upload to stack catalog. Yeah. And we registered this stack collection catalog to GeoHub. And for the rapid change assessment tool, this is some technique we used. Yeah. First, user select an asset from our stack catalog. Yeah. So for the from date of nighttime light to date of nighttime light, and also for the cloud cover asset as well. And after selecting this one, we create a virtual raster to combine these four data sets and pass virtual raster URL to Ttira with applied our custom algorithm of RCA. Yeah. So after that, we can do such analysis, yeah, showing showing this change dynamically, by comparing from and to data set. So, and then actually this GeoHub was also presented in Hosfoji Kosovo. Maybe some of you, if you are in Kosovo, maybe you have seen this GeoHub before. And that time, we had quite a terrible UI. And but after Kosovo, we got a UI designer. And last year, I actually changed most of UI completely from scratch. So now we have quite a nice UI, UX, brought more unified UI to GeoHub. And also we implemented the user authentications. Now, theoretically, all UN agencies can be, UN agencies staff can be authenticated to GeoHub. Maybe some UN agencies might need some approval by IT through GeoHub to log in, but all UN staff can be can use this GeoHub. And also, I think most of you here have GitHub account. You can log in to GeoHub using your GitHub account, try GeoHub to maybe upload some of your data set and visualize them. And I'm curious to know that the Hosfoji community people how think this this GeoHub. And let me know what you feel this GeoHub after using. And also we implemented the user permission feature. The user can set the viewer, editor, or settings, or owner settings for each data set on the map. And recently, we finally have comprehensive user documentation. And also, we implemented the static image API with MapRibel native. So this is quite similar to Mapbox static image API. But our static image API can use the PM tiles as well. And also, So these are the updates for the GeoHub since the last course of Hosfoji. And what's next for GeoHub? So we are thinking, we should bring more analytical tools to GeoHub. Currently, one of my colleagues are working on adding a flood detection algorithm to GeoHub. And also, there is a project to add another dashboard for clean energy equity index dashboard. And we also want to develop zonal statistics feature. For example, maybe compute affected population and buildings in specific polygon area like that. And also, we want to develop story map feature for Geo by using GeoHub maps. Maybe, we need some GUI to configure stories and allow users to share some story maps. And also want to bring more third-party data to GeoHub. For example, maybe we want to support some WMS, WMTS services, so we can bring more third-party data through OGC API to GeoHub. And this last one, electricity dashboard version 2 is coming soon. Thank you for coming to my presentation. So GeoHub is developed and maintained as open source. So you can access to GeoHub source code, all GeoHub source code through GitHub. And also through this QR code left side, you can try our GeoHub website. Log in with your GitHub account and let us know what you think about this GeoHub. And feel free to open any pull request, maybe issues or discussion in GitHub if you have any questions or maybe some request of features. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Jin. Do we have questions? Yeah.
Thank you. First of all, thank you very much for your talk. I think it's very interesting that UNDP is moving forward in this direction to becoming more data-driven. So I was wondering if you have any examples of the data actually being used and what kind of applications there are in the field of the analysis you've shown, or maybe other examples of this platform actually being used in the field as well.
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Do you have any examples of people who work for UNDP who have been using the platform on site somewhere?
On-site, using this platform on-site, yeah.
Yeah, who is using the platform?
Currently, this platform is not using in the on-site, like maybe from mobile app, yeah, but yeah. Yeah.
Does it answer your question?
Yeah.
Other questions? I have maybe a question in regards to the development. Is it a team internal in the UN, or is it developed by external partners?
So this GeoHub is developed in-house. Yeah. So actually there are three members, me and the other two members, are employed by UNDP and Baki.
We have a bit more time for questions. The selection of the technologies that you use for the GeoHub, how is that informed? Did your team say, okay, here this is the best open source for that use case, or how do you choose the technology to develop those things?
Firstly, yeah, actually, we chose Svelte for the front-end framework because actually we thought that React is too complicated and too difficult, and we found Svelte is quite nice, yeah, and we decided to use this Svelte instead of Svelte. Svelte is one of JavaScript framework like React. Yeah, that is also open source. Yeah, so we chose Svelte Kit as a main JavaScript framework, and actually it's quite nice and very very easy to implement compared to React, and easy to learn the technologies. And also my Mapribre, that Mapribre can. That we chose Mapribre because we wanted to use the tile, vector tiles, yeah, and the Mapribre can be the best one.
It's the best one.
Yeah.
So I think I'm personally also in a situation where I had to choose for different front ends, mapping front ends to use vector tiles.
Yeah.
I also have good experience with OpenLayers. How is it with MapLibre, other classic functionality like, I don't know, selecting, feature query? How does that work?
So you mean the other backend side maybe?
Yeah, like those typical activities that you want to do, like.
So also maybe, that we are using cloud optimized format like Cog and PM tiles because that is easy to deploy, just upload to blob storage and can Mapribre can consume directly. And also we are using Ttila. Ttila is a raster tile, dynamic raster tile server. Yeah. Yeah. So
I wanted to know about like all the data sets that you are publishing on UNDP. What's the license behind it? Like, can somebody else use those to create reports and or use them in their dashboards or publish maps?
This GeoHub is licensed and open source license. BSD 3 license is our license.
So we can use the data without.
Yeah. And also data, when user upload data, user can choose open data license. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Thank you very much, Jin.
Okay.
Give another applause.
Thank you.